Telematie, bye bye, sumabo. Telematie, bye bye, sumabo. Telematie, sumabo. Telematie, sumabo. Telematie, bye bye, sumabo.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, here. I warmly welcome you to this conference in the framework of Terra Madre's Salone del Gusto. My name is Nina Wolf, and I'm the acting chairwoman of Slow Food in Germany. In Germany, we have 14,000 Slow Food members and many more people who like good, clean, fair, and healthy food. It's a great honor for me to be your moderator today. All over Europe and certainly beyond, people get more and more interested in healthy food and a healthy lifestyle. Different food styles and diets are discussed. Some of them are very popular, and especially when they enable a natural lifestyle. And this is actually the case of the Mediterranean diet, which many physicians have indeed declared to be the golden standard. So the best you can do for your health. And we will hear in a minute how exactly this Mediterranean diet is composed. The most popular benefit from this form of nutrition is certainly that you can reach an old age by eating well. Eat well, mangiare bene, and you will get very old. Doesn't that sound great? But I think, in fact, it is much more than that. The Mediterranean diet is a much more holistic concept. It includes, for example, a person's activities and the relationships we have with each other and with the world. And when we look at the origins of the Mediterranean diet, the traditional way in which people have cultivated this lifestyle, then we see that it is a great relationship between humans, animals, and nature. It included a respect for nature in its originality. Natural cycles, the seasonality of food, and food actually was only what could be found in nature. And this brings us to today's topic. If today we focus so much on the health benefits of the Mediterranean diet, let's not forget that a good and clean and fair food still have certain characteristics that originally belonged to this diet. One of the many things I found interesting when preparing a little bit for this discussion is it is widely recognized that there is not the one Mediterranean diet. It is a collective concept for a way people around the Mediterranean live and eat. There are many forms, depending on whether you live in Italy, in Egypt, Spain, or other Mediterranean countries. And in fact, our speakers today reflect this great diversity. We have Antonia Trichopoulou from Greece, Angela Saba from Italy, Nahaya Al-Muhaysain from Jordan, and Suhet Azenout from Morocco. I will now hand over to Antonia Trichopoulou, who is the president of the Hellenic Health Foundation and professor emeritus of the University of Athens. And she will give us an in-depth description of the Mediterranean diet in light of quality requirements. Over to you, Antonia.
I'm sorry, it's my pleasure and my privilege to speak to this Slow Food meeting and also to talk about Mediterranean diet, a topic that expresses both my scientific beliefs and my love for the Mediterranean way of living. My, an ancient Greek philosopher, Aristophanes, can I have the slides, please? My slides? Can I have the slides, the projection of the slides? No? Well, anyway, I will continue without slides. So It's easy to have, I will have these lights or no? No. Well, I will continue without slides then. Okay, Nina? Do you hear me?
Yes, okay. Please go ahead. I'm not linked to the technical people, so I cannot tell you what's wrong with the slides now. Okay. If you're comfortable, please continue like that.
Okay, so I will continue. The ancient Greek philosopher Aristides said that, tell us that the beginning of a right education is the examination of, okay, here we are, thank you. The beginning of a right education is the examination of words. So having said that, I think that's crucial to clarify the definition of the Mediterranean diet because more than often is misused, be intentionally or not. Just, I cannot move again. The next slides, please. So, then I will proceed with the I don't know what is happening. I will proceed with the definition of the Mediterranean diet. The Mediterranean diet is the dietary pattern prevailing in the olive tree grown areas of the Mediterranean basin till the beginning of the 60s. And then somebody will ask why in the olive tree grown areas of the Mediterranean basin? Because olive oil is central to the Mediterranean diet. I could claim also that Mediterranean diet doesn't, the traditional Mediterranean diet does not exist without olive oil. And why till the beginning of the 60s? Because after the 60s, as you know, a lot of socioeconomic, the next please, a lot of socioeconomic changes came in the area. And as a result, the way of the dietary patterns in the area, they have changed dramatically, I would say, today. And also the way of preparing the foods has changed a lot. So briefly, I will say that Mediterranean diet is characterized by the high consumption of fruit and vegetables and legumes, mainly unprocessed. And it's a plant-based diet without saying no to animal products. But the plant food is prevails in the Mediterranean dietary pattern. Of course, we consume food, fish, moderate high consumption, depending on the proximity to the sea. And also we consume milk and milk products, mainly in the form of cheese and yogurt, because in the Mediterranean Sea, we are lactate deficient and we do not like to drink so much milk, but we eat a lot of cheese and yogurt. And of course, the wine, if social norms accept it, is consumed regularly by the adults during meals in moderation, to a lesser extent by women, and of course, never by children. I will say that because, sorry, but the slides, they do not move fast, so I do not know how to deal with this issue. So I'll continue, but what I'm saying does not correspond to the slides which is projected. Here you can see the Mediterranean diet pyramid, the way it was accepted by the Greek government as our national guidelines in 1999. And so the Mediterranean diet was recognized in the 2010 by UNESCO as an intangible cultural heritage because as I mentioned before, the Mediterranean diet is not only foods the way it describes in the pyramid, but is a way of living. And the Mediterranean diet is a social practice based on the set of skills, knowledge, practices, and traditions, in which tradition play a very important role, as and also they are included in the tradition in way of the way we are using the foods, the way we are preparing them, the way we are cultivating them, the way we are processing, the way we are keeping the foods. So it's a whole tradition on this, and I think that the next speaker will expand on that. So it is widely recognized, as Nina mentioned before, that the Mediterranean diet is internationally now accepted and based on solid scientific evidence that it's a healthy diet. But this could be partly attributed to the Mediterranean, traditional Mediterranean foods. And on the one hand, as I mentioned before, the environment changed a lot, and the traditional foods, I could say that they are now an endangered species. And remembering again this old Greek philosopher, we have to define what we mean by the term traditional food, because this term also intentionally or unintentionally more than often is misused, and there are a lot of myths and misconception by using both terms, Mediterranean, traditional Mediterranean diet, and traditional Mediterranean food. And I think this is one of the reasons we are here, in order to protect all this heritage. So briefly, traditional foods, according to the European Commission, are the foods which they were on the market one generation before. That means in 2020, whatever was on the market could claim that it's traditional. And for a country like Italy and Greece and several countries in the Middle East, in North Africa, traditional food go back, if not to millennia, but to several hundred years. So we need urgently a new definition of traditional foods, which of course they are foods which they are like other similar, there are similar products of the same category, but the traditional food, we have to know the traditional ingredient, respect the traditional composition, and the traditional type of production. This is very, very important. Having said that, I will say that we have to address this issue about what we mean, what we say traditional foods and Mediterranean diet, and dispel particularly those foods that label as Mediterranean, and they are not. Well, the Mediterranean diet, the last 10 years, has gradually evolved from being a healthy diet, a sustainable dietary pattern, because Mediterranean diet has a low environmental impact. As I mentioned before, it's a plant-based diet. It's a diet which does not produce greenhouse emissions. It's a diet, the Mediterranean products, they do not use a lot of resources. They do not use a lot of land or a lot of water. So they have a very, very low carbon print, and it's considered as as a sustainable model for a sustainable diet. Since we are talking about Mediterranean diet, and before we spoke about the olive oil, I wish to mention that the olive trees, apart of being a buyer to the certification, the olive orchards are a sink for carbon dioxide, because the olive trees, they produce much less carbon dioxide than they absorb in the soil. And this is very, very important, I think, for the environment and for the climate. And now I will finish by mentioning that in 2019, the Lancet Commission, a commission who was sponsored by the Lancet Journal, published a report on how the diet link human health and environmental sustainability. In this report, they recommend a universal diet, which is friendly to environment. And I could say that there is a lot of resemblance to the Mediterranean diet. Having said that, we have to consider the past in order to proceed to the future on a solid ground. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Antonia. That was very interesting for us to have this introduction. And I really liked the link you made in the end to the Eat Lancet report and the planetary diet, in fact, it promotes. Actually, in this report, it is said that 80% of what we eat should be plant-based food. Do you think that that matches more or less with the Mediterranean diet? We can't hear you, unfortunately, Antonia.
Do you hear me now? Can you repeat your question? You was asking something about traditional Mediterranean diet and plant food.
Yes, exactly. I asked you the Eat Lancet report. You mentioned in the end it promotes a planetary diet,
yes,
which is based on plants for 80%. And do you think that this quotient of 80%, does this match the part that plants have in the Mediterranean diet?
Oh yes, because it's very similar to Mediterranean diet, the diet which is recommended by the ITE report. Because as I mentioned before, the Mediterranean diet is a plant-based diet, but it does not say no to anything. It's a question of quantity, not of quality. Mm-hmm. So we eat meat, but we eat meat. I remember when I was a child, we were eating it every Sunday, but it was meat with potato. It was potatoes with meat. That means that potatoes was the biggest part of the plate, a small piece of meat. And now, but now we eat meat with potatoes or with pasta or, you know. So, I mean, it's very close. I think a part of olive oil, which of course cannot be universally used because first it's not produced, maybe they do not like the olive oil everywhere in the planet. But the essence is the Mediterranean diet, it's very close.
Yes. Well, I think I would have many more questions for you. Perhaps we can come back to that later, because of course we're also curious to hear our other panelists. And we will now turn, in fact, to a couple of good practices. And our speakers will talk about particular food products. They will explain to us how the products are produced And also how the production chain differs, in fact, from the conventional chain, the production chain, the ideal production chain, I imagine, in the Mediterranean diet context. And our focus in this small interventions is how do good, clean and fair production choices affect the health of humans and the planet? And my first speaker will be Angela Saba. Angela is from Italy, and she's a shepherd and a producer of the Maremma raw milk pecorino, which is a slow food presidium. Angela will explain to us the production of this pecorino and give us an example on how animal welfare and human welfare are linked. Angela, over to you.
Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti. Allora, come hai già presentato, sono una pastora casara che lavora il latte dei propri animali ormai da tanti anni, dal 2006, e lo trasforma esclusivamente a latte crudo. Latte crudo senza fermenti esterni aggiunti. L'azienda che conduco insieme a mio fratello è appunto un'azienda di famiglia. Abbiamo sempre fatto il formaggio e abbiamo sempre, fino al 2006, dopo che è iniziata la sperimentazione con l'università, consegnavamo il latte a un caseificio industriale. Dopo la sperimentazione con l'università, che è un po' anche il mondo dalla quale provengo, per i miei studi universitari, abbiamo deciso, visti i risultati della sperimentazione, di lavorare il nostro latte, mettere in piedi, costruire un piccolo caseificio artigianale e lavorare il nostro latte per poi metterlo in vendita. È una storia particolare di piccoli successi, perché siamo partiti con la collaborazione con l'università nel 2006, ci hanno proposto una sperimentazione particolare, arricchire l'alimentazione degli animali con dei semi di lino, quindi puntare tutto sugli acidi grassi polinsaturi che già erano presenti nel pascolo. Noi abbiamo sempre alimentato il gregge in maniera naturale, molto naturale. Abbiamo sempre rispettato il benessere animale e le mie pecore, le mie capre sono libere di pascolare e quindi questa grande biodiversità ci ha anche facilitato poi nelle analisi del latte, che sono piaciute tanto ai professori dell'università, e da lì è partita questa voglia di sperimentare e di arricchire ulteriormente. Quindi pascoli naturali, molto tanta biodiversità e una piccola integrazione di semi di lino. Sono ricchi di omega 3 e questa alimentazione è molto seguita, perché per fare un passo del genere devi avere anche delle conoscenze tecniche di base. È un'alimentazione proteica particolare, e questo tipo di sperimentazione ci ha portato ad arricchire il latte, ripeto, in maniera molto naturale, di acidi grassi polinsaturi, omega 6 ed omega 3, perfettamente bilanciati. Questo ha permesso di dare la possibilità anche a chi non mangiava il formaggio perché soffre di colesterolemia, di poter dare a queste persone la voglia, la possibilità di poter mangiare il formaggio senza aver paura di alzare il loro colesterolo cattivo, l'LDL. È una sperimentazione che è stata fatta lavorando in maniera separata il latte del gregge. Abbiamo avuto questi che vedete, sono i miei pastori maremmani. Racconto anche un po' di slide. Abbiamo pastori maremmani perché purtroppo abbiamo anche casi di predazione da lupi e quindi dobbiamo difenderci. E vedete nelle slide che scorrono, sono le mie creazioni, io li chiamo i miei figli. Ora quando vedo le foto sono talmente coinvolta che perdo il filo del discorso. E comunque abbiamo dato questo prodotto così ottenuto da due tipologie di latte diverso, l'alimentazione convenzionale, quindi il gruppo controllo, e un gregge trattato con questa alimentazione nuova, così diciamo. Sono state fatte due lavorazioni e in entrambi i casi sempre latte crudo senza fermenti esterni aggiunti, e in entrambi i casi si è visto come veramente c'era una differenza fra l'alimentazione convenzionale, comunque buona, comunque ricca, e questa alimentazione fatta da essenze particolari e semi di lino, era veramente molto più ricca di acidi grassi buoni polinizzatori. E sono stati questo tipo di formaggio è stato mangiato dai pazienti di una clinica qui in Italia per 4 mesi, poi anche negli anni successivi, e il tasso di colesterolemia non solo non si è alzato, ma addirittura il colesterolo cattivo si è abbassato di una piccola percentuale. Questa sperimentazione è durata 3 anni. E io ho resistito, siamo stati bravi, non abbiamo mai detto di questo prodotto che aveva queste caratteristiche, e quindi veniva venduto il formaggio così com'era. Nel 2009 c'è stato poi il benestare dell'università e dei medici della clinica dove era stato mandato il formaggio, e siamo potuti partire anche con la vendita e dire al mondo intero: ce l'abbiamo fatta, abbiamo un prodotto speciale. E da lì poi è stato tutto un susseguirsi di sperimentazioni, di controlli, però ci siamo resi conto che in realtà sperimentare aiuta, la ricerca è fondamentale, ma poi quando lavori in maniera del tutto naturale, quando credi nel benessere degli animali, un animale per darti tanto deve stare bene, e le pecore, le capre devono pascolare. Gli animali in natura vanno a cercarsi sicuramente ciò che per loro è migliore, quindi non è una monocultura o una sola cosa, hanno bisogno di tanta biodiversità, poter scegliere e arricchire quel latte. E quindi alla fine, rispettando la natura, hai già tutto in mano. Si tratta di tornare un pochettino indietro, ma con tutto quello che la tecnologia e l'innovazione ti permette di avere, riscopri che la natura ti ha già fornito tutte le basi per fare un latte eccezionale. E quindi questo è quello che abbiamo continuato a fare, ed è il motivo per cui nel 2016, grazie a Slow Food, siamo entrati nel presidio del pecorino al latte crudo. E ci tengo tanto a portare avanti un po' questa battaglia che sta facendo lo Slow Food sul non utilizzo di fermenti esterni, soprattutto per chi lavora al latte crudo. Latte crudo non è altro che un latte non trattato termicamente, quindi può essere appena munto o refrigerato a 4 gradi, portato a una temperatura massima che non deve superare 37-38 gradi. 37 gradi è la temperatura alla quale il latte esce sterile dalla mammella della pecora. Quindi tutto ciò che supera questa temperatura qui comunque va a modificare in parte le caratteristiche peculiari del latte, comprese le caratteristiche organolettiche. E noi rimaniamo sempre intorno ai 35 gradi, proprio per non distruggere questa biodiversità immensa che ci regala il latte. E soprattutto non utilizziamo fermenti esterni chimici fatti ovviamente in laboratorio, che non appartengono al nostro territorio, non appartengono al nostro latte. È un ceppo naturale di batteri, di fermenti che lavorano benissimo. Noi abbiamo scelto di non lavorare neanche a siero innesto o latte innesto, proprio per rimanere totalmente inalterata questa caratteristica importante. Io desidero proprio non omologare, non informare. Tutti i giorni ho un prodotto diverso. Ovviamente lavora benissimo anche chi lavora al latte innesto o siero innesto, però è proprio una scelta che ha fatto Angela di rimanere con questa biodiversità immensa che mi dà una grande gioia. E quindi continuiamo con questa cosa del latte crudo, oltretutto il non trattamento termico mi ha permesso di fare un'altra collaborazione con l'Università di Parma. Ho dei fermentati naturali ricchissimi da un punto di vista probiotico e l'Università di Parma sta lavorando a questa sperimentazione, ha trovato delle cose incredibili e viva il latte crudo. Quindi noi continueremo su questa strada con entusiasmo. Dimmi Nina, vuoi chiedermi qualcosa?
Yes, thank you, Angela. Angela, I think we will have to come to an end with the pecorino in order to be able to hear our other panelists as well and have a little bit of space discussion as well. But I really appreciate your enthusiasm and share actually your take that it's a love for biodiversity that should direct the way we proceed with our food and how we proceed with our animals. And thank you so much for this very nice example, how process quality actually leads to a better health as well of people and of the planet. Thank you so much. And I would like to turn now to Nehaya from Jordan. And Nehaya is an agricultural engineer. She's a sommelier in olive oil, which sounds very interesting and tasty. And she's also the spokesperson of Slow Food Women of Olive Oil Community in Jordan. So, Nehaya, I'm very interested in what you have to say for us.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me well? Yes? Okay. So, hello everyone. I would like first to thank you, thank everyone who is contributing to spread the culture of healthy, natural and blessed fruit, on top of which is extra virgin olive oil. Actually, this is what we are doing now in Jordan, which is a part of Slow Food as Jordanian Women's Network for Olive Oil, which was initiated since March this year, last year, 2020, among which we worked to achieve the spread of the culture of extra virgin olive oil as medicine and food and preserving the traditional foods and healthy traditions that have been inherited, which had the greatest impact on improving health and immunity, which affects the increase in the average ages of people in Jordan compared to these years in which fast food negatively affected the health of society. Today, I will speak on behalf of Dr. Yara Ghanayini, with whom we formed the Slow Food Community in Jordan. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Okay, next please. So today I will talk about the olive oil and the Jordanian gastronomy. Next, please. Okay. Now, as well known, olive, it's one of the best oils for health and has countless uses in cooking as food. Gastronomy and cuisine are essential elements for the culture and identity of a certain people here in Jordan. Next, please. Now, you look at this very beautiful old tree. This is in Wadi Ram. And this is around, can you please make next? Because I want, yes. There was a study out by a French Jordanian team of archaeologists that demonstrated Jordan is the homeland of the oldest olive trees. They proved that olives were grown in Wadi Ram. This is a very amazing valley, which called Wadi Ram, at the south of Jordan, that they found that this area was planted olive trees before 5400 BC. Next, please. So Jordanians are culturally and socially attached to the olive tree. It is embedded in their local heritage and is always included in their dietary system. Next, please. Now, The olive tree was one of the first plants cultivated in the Levant. Of course, it was all the area here, it was called the large Syria, includes Lebanon and Palestine, Jordan, and yes, Lebanon, yeah, Palestine, Jordan. So the oldest archaeological evidence confirmed the presence of olive cultivation in the Dead Sea and shows that olive growing is an actively practiced since the 4th millennium BC. So the olive tree is one of the most salient symbols in the history and culture of Jordan. Its role was not limited to being a food, and it has always been associated with life and customs of the community. It has also an important role in religion, heritage, and culture, and forms part of the identity of this people. Apart from being used as food, it is also used in cosmetics, particularly for making creams, shampoos, soap, and perfumes. It's also used in medicine as a remedy for various diseases and in the manufacture of many medicines and medicinal creams. The olive trees, olives, and olive oil have a prominent place in the Jordanian popular wisdom. Actually, many proverbs indicate its importance and show practices related to the olive planting process. It's important as source of food and medicines, as we are doing now in Jordan. Now, you look, this is a very delicious traditional food, all cooked by olive oil. In Jordan, we have considerable number of dishes that are prepared with olive oil, being one of the most appreciated oils for its properties and benefits. Since the olive tree is one of the oldest crop here in Jordan, hope you can come and taste them. Now, food and cuisine are essential elements for the culture and identity of a specific people. In Jordan, olive oil forms an essential part of the traditional breakfast, and even not Jordan, all of the region. For the example, dipping the bread in olive oil with thyme. I hope you can taste it, or you have tasted. It's called za'atar in Arabic. It's a mixture of thyme and other spices, very delicious. We dip the bread in the olive oil and then in the thyme, which is dry, so it is a very tasty. Also, raw olive oil is added to a considerable number of breakfast dishes, such as hummus. Hummus, it's a chickpeas that it's grinded and put something from sesame, and then we put garlic and we put some additives, of course natural, like maybe yogurt or something. And to make hummus, then lebanese, it's from milk. Next, please. Also, pickled olives. We have our traditional way to pickle the olives. We do not put any additives. You see here, you have the eggplant with olive oil. It's a pickled inside. There is a walnut, and you have many of the salads with green peas, with green beans, with carrots. All we make pickled a salad, and we put olive oil. So this is the hummus, and this very beautiful. It is from a nursery. We had a workshop there to encourage the children to like and to love olive oil and sandwiches with it, so that we make we pickle the olive fruits with them. It was so interesting with the children, yes. So there are many popular sayings that mention the olive tree and its oil. Some are figured and others are actually refers to the olive tree, olives, oil, and their cultivation, providing valuable ethnographic information on beliefs, folk, and customs, and traditional agriculture. Now we have it'am ibnak, it's in Arabic, that you can read it by English alphabets. It's it'am ibnak zayt warmi bilbayt, that you feed your child with olive oil and keep him in the house. So if you have olive oil, so you have food. That saying highlights the nutritional value of olive oil and its health benefits, and indicates that the liquid can be used as food to the to strengthen the body. Yes. Now also we have another wisdom. It's Azat Masamir al-Masab al-Masam, that olive or oil is the screw of the wrist, according to popular belief in Jordan. Olive oil strengthens the wrist. Actually, a cutaneous application of olive oil is thought to have a beneficial effect on the joints and nerves. The analogy is that olive oil is how screws make wrists stronger and firmer. I think also this is in our religion. Thank you for listening. Thank you for this opportunity.
Oh, sorry. You couldn't hear me. I didn't do it strong enough. Okay. Thank you so much. This was very interesting. I think you showed us perfectly that the food, the health of the food is also the health of the community, and it is also the hospitality. And in fact, our pleasure to enjoy food altogether. And I think that is very important. It's a very important aspect of health. And we often forget that what makes us healthy is not only what we actually take, but also what is around us, people we connect with while we're eating. So thank you very much for this. I have one question for you. And this is about the quality of the olive oil. Are there also industrial ways now in Jordan to produce the olive oil, or is it all traditional? And how would you say, is there a difference in the quality?
Actually, we have 136 olive mills. 95% of them are high techniques. We produce extra virgin olive oil. We have just around 4 of the olive mills that are very old, maybe more than 100 or 120 years. It's a stone, and it's like a museum. We leave them as museums. So now we are, since maybe 2002, Jordan was a member in the International Olive Council. And then, so we have the legislation that we are now with the olive oil, legislation with the IOC. So we follow this. We have extra virgin, and we have virgin, and we have ordinary. Hope now there will be more ordinary, because we are looking forward to improve the quality. We hear many of the customers now, they want it on the consumers. They wanted to eat extra virgin olive oil. We have 5 panels in Jordan for tasting, and I am from the first panel since 2003. So yes, all we are looking for the quality. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Nahaya. We are now turning to Suhet. And Suhet is from Morocco, as I said, and she's a trainer in agroecology, an oil producer, and the coordinator of the Rif Small Spelt Presidium and Slow Food Jabals pour la biodiversité community. And you will have to explain us what that is. So go ahead, please, Suhet.
Bonjour tout le monde. Alors en premier, je remercie Slow Food de m'avoir invité pour participer à cette conférence. Ce thème choisi est vraiment important, surtout qu'en ce moment, toutes les personnes cherchent à booster leur immunité face au Covid, et la diète méditerranéenne est une excellente voie. Aussi, j'ai choisi de vous parler de notre biodiversité et le bénéfice santé, en citant surtout notre expérience avec une céréale locale, ancienne, que nous avions sauvegardée, multipliée et valorisée depuis maintenant 5 ans. Et bien sûr, on l'a inscrite comme sentinelle de Slow Food. Alors, on passe au deuxième slide. Ma présentation s'articulera comme suit. Tout d'abord, je vais essayer de vous présenter notre communauté d'Ejvela. Puis de suite, je détaillerai notre expérience avec le petit épeautre, surtout en tant que céréale méditerranéenne et le bénéfice santé qui en découle. Puis je conclurai en mettant en avant l'importance de l'agriculture durable dans le maintien de la diète méditerranéenne. Alors, on passe au troisième slide. Effectivement, je fais partie de la communauté qu'on appelle les Ejvela. Ces derniers occupent la majeure partie du Rif occidental, nord-ouest du Maroc. Le pays des Ejvela se caractérise par une forte densité démographique. La dimension rurale de la population reste très forte. Cette communauté s'intègre dans un contexte naturel et socio-économique qui la fait vraiment appartenir à un système de production du type agro-silvo-pastoral. Ce système se caractérise par l'utilisation à la fois des terres agricoles, des parcours et des forêts. L'agriculture et l'élevage, le petit élevage, constituent les secteurs de subsistance caractérisés par l'utilisation de techniques culturelles, traditionnelles, et l'élevage extensif, principalement de caprins et d'ovins. Cet agro-système traditionnel de nos régions est favorable à la biodiversité et notamment à un taux élevé de l'endémisme de sa fleur. Alors, on va parler maintenant surtout de petites épeautres. Donc, en ce qui concerne, on passe à la slide suivante. En ce qui concerne l'agrodiversité de nos territoires, on peut souligner 2 caractéristiques importantes. C'est effectivement la persistance de cultures anciennes. Et là, on va citer comme céréale donc, la culture de Shkalia, c'est ce qu'on appelle en arabe Shkalia, c'est le petit épeautre, en italien, donc piccolo farro. Et bien sûr, il y a aussi le seigle ancien, qu'on est en train maintenant aussi d'essayer de le sauvegarder, de multiplier. Il y a aussi, on se base surtout aussi sur les légumineuses, comme fèves, lentilles, pois chiches. Et puis, au niveau des Méditerranées, du pourtour méditerranéen, il y a l'importance des fruitiers, bien sûr l'olivier, le figuier et la vigne. Alors, cependant, je vais parler surtout du petit épeautre. On reste sur la slide d'avant. Je vais parler surtout du petit épeautre qui a fait partie du patrimoine alimentaire des tribus des Ejvela fort longtemps. Malheureusement, cette semence était en train de disparaître ces dernières années. Et notre communauté Slow Food a multiplié cette semence et on l'a valorisée et on l'a inscrite comme sentinelle Slow Food. Alors, avec cette semence, on fait bien sûr du pain et du couscous principalement, qui sont les aliments traditionnels de notre région et du Maroc, en fait. Cette céréale a un bénéfice certain au niveau de la santé. Elle est très riche en glucides, et elle est riche en protéines. On peut dire que 100 grammes, et ça c'est des études, on va voir les publications après, 100 grammes de petite épeautre apportent à l'organisme la quantité quotidienne vraiment conseillée de protéines. Il apporte à l'organisme des acides aminés et surtout les 8 acides aminés essentiels, c'est-à-dire que le corps ne peut pas fabriquer. Et surtout, il y a un acide aminé vraiment très intéressant, c'est la lysine. Et la lysine, on ne la trouve pas dans les autres céréales. Par contre, dans le petit épeautre, on va la trouver. Et surtout, la richesse en minéraux. Le petit épeautre se distingue par une importance au niveau des minéraux qui se révèle vraiment très intéressante. par exemple, elle est riche en magnésium, elle est 4 fois plus riche de magnésium que son équivalent en riz brun. 5 fois plus que 100 grammes de steak. C'est très intéressant. On peut dire que aussi elle est très riche en calcium, en phosphore. En phosphore, elle est 5 fois plus riche que son équivalent en soja, par exemple. Et puis, maintenant avec le Covid, il y a pas mal qui cherchent le zinc partout, même en complément alimentaire. Eh bien, le petit épeautre est riche en zinc. Il est 6 fois plus riche en zinc que son équivalent en riz brun, par exemple. Et le petit épeautre est très digeste, il a une parfaite digestibilité et il a une faible teneur en gluten, d'où l'intérêt des consommateurs qui sont à la recherche maintenant de plus en plus du petit épeautre. Cette richesse, elle vient du fait que cette plante est adaptée au terrain sec, pierreux, pauvre. Elle compense ses difficultés de croissance par une accumulation d'éléments. Alors, au niveau des cultures, on met, bien sûr, on adopte l'agroécologie dans notre conduite. Il y a surtout la rotation des cultures et la rotation se fait avec les légumineuses. Et principalement, on reste sur 3 ans. De rotation. C'est le minimum. Quelquefois, on va jusqu'à 4-5 ans. On fait des rotations avec les légumineuses annuelles, avec des pluriannuelles des fois, ou des engrais verts. Les objectifs de ce système de rotation est de garantir l'équilibre sanitaire de la plante, du grain et du sol pour limiter le développement des adventices. Les plantes indésirables, qu'on appelle indésirables, d'assurer un rendement, avec cette technique de culture, on assure un rendement assez intéressant et des résultats en poids spécifiques et un taux de protéines adéquat. Cette semence est vraiment très intéressante parce qu'elle est très résistante, notamment avec les changements climatiques, où des fois il y a des pluies diluviennes maintenant qui arrivent, où il y a rareté des pluies. Cette semence, cette céréale s'adapte bien dans nos terrains de montagne. Alors, en ce moment, pour maintenir nos habitudes alimentaires, nous continuons aussi à sauvegarder et multiplier d'autres semences locales, de céréales notamment, et de légumineuses. Comme céréale qu'on est en train de sauvegarder maintenant, c'est le seigle local du RIF. Et là, on va aller chercher ces richesses, etc. Et en parler, bien sûr, autour de nous, parce que maintenant, on se focalise surtout sur le petit épeautre qu'on a fini de valoriser. Maintenant, on est passé à d'autres semences. Et cela permet vraiment la préservation de notre patrimoine relative à la richesse génétique de nos plantes locales. Donc, quand on pratique ce genre de culture, que tout ça, c'est vraiment, on est en train de sauvegarder la richesse de notre territoire. Alors, pour conclure, je dirais que si la diète méditerranéenne est un ensemble de savoir-faire, effectivement, de connaissances, et qui sont étroitement liées aux habitudes sociales liées à l'agriculture et à la production, l'agriculture qui est pratiquée par les agriculteurs de la région méditerranéenne est la garante, et vraiment c'est la garantie de maintenir cette qualité de diète méditerranéenne. Et enfin, je vous remercie de votre attention et je remercie l'engagement de Slow Food pour la promotion de cette agriculture au service de la santé. Merci encore. Et donc, il y a des publications, notamment d'une professeure qui s'appelle Wafa Belchbib, qui a parlé beaucoup sur la qualité du petit épeautre. Donc, je vais laisser plus tard des références dans ce sens. Il y a des références qui sont inscrites, effectivement. Donc, il y a le professeur Atel Mohamed de l'université de Tétouan qui a parlé des agrosystèmes, et puis Wafa Belchbib. Je vous remercie.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much, Suhed. Thank you so much for your intervention. This was really impressive to see how traditional farming and local plants are so important for the Mediterranean diet. I will now quickly hand over to Antonia, who will give us a little summary of what we heard and some comments, and then we will have to come to an end, unfortunately.
Okay, do you hear me now? Do you hear me? Okay, so, well, indeed I was impressed by the three presentations, although I was impressed by the naturally fermented pecorino cheese without starters and by using the raw milk, and also from the traditional farming and local production by Netraya and Suhad. Do I pronounce correctly the name? I don't know. But this is those approaches, they are very, very, very good. And this approach forces us to rethink agricultural system and diets. But I have some concerns because I'm trying in my country, in Greece also, to promote traditional foods, traditional ways of preparing, not using the right starters for yogurt, for example, or for bread, and so on. But at the end, what we produce delicatessen foods, foods which are very tasty, very healthy, but in small amount. And we try to persuade people to use them locally because the essence of the Mediterranean diet is produced locally and consumed locally. So I think that it's very important that there are persons or groups or countries or villages which they follow this line of production. But also we have to think how they will survive. Okay. So that's all. And I think that slow food is doing a very important work towards this direction on agricultural systems to diets, which they are crucial. And it's the base of the Mediterranean diet. The pyramid and the health, the health aspects of the Mediterranean diet, okay. I mean, they were very well accepted. And the issue is, why and how? Okay.
Yes, thank you.
You have some questions?
Yes, thank you so much to remind us also that it's still sometimes a luxury to live healthy and to live the true Mediterranean diet or other forms of natural diet in a local context. Thank you so much to all the speakers. I'm afraid we ran out of time, but we had very, very interesting interesting presentations from all of you. So thanks a lot for that, and thanks a lot to Antonia, who summarized that for us and also did a very good introduction. So I think this is a topic that will have to be continued, and actually you will soon all have the opportunity, and I would like to invite you, in fact, to follow our next Terra Madre events, and in particular the next conference on the 5th of February on the health of the planet and the people. And I think we will have more insight into the planetary health diet at that moment. And also you can, of course, discover more on the Slow Food website on this topic. And also we have a new small guide on healthy eating. So we live in this very weird and difficult times where health is our number one topic and we look into numbers every day. But today we had a good example of how we can stay healthy in our food and also in our minds by following a good natural and regional diet like the Mediterranean diet. So I conclude by saying what we say all the time these days, stay healthy people and also eat healthy and have a very good weekend. Thank you very much for your attention and for your interest.
The future of our planet is decided at the table, in our daily food choices. What do we know about what we eat? How do we choose? Where do we buy it? You can make a difference and contribute to a future where everyone has access to food that is good. Eating must be a pleasure for everyone. We all have a right to food that is healthy, natural, fresh, and seasonal. Clean. Being aware helps us to choose food that is good for our health and the health of our planet. Fair. Knowing our food means making choices that are fair to us, to the producers, and to future generations. Slow Food has been working for over 30 years to defend biodiversity and fight the climate crisis by promoting good, clean, and fair food for all. Support Slow Food. Let's act together for the common good. Go to donate.slowfood.com/en and follow us at terramadreselunadelgusta.com.
Kelematie, bye bye, sumambo. Kelematie, bye bye, sumambo. Kelematie, sumambo. Kelematie, bye bye.